Recording in progress.
The YSCMR to deliver the welcome speech for the occasion.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Young Scientist Conference on Multidisciplinary Research, YSCMR 2022, virtual international conference organized by the Young Scientist Association of National Institute of Fundamental Studies. I would like to sincerely welcome our keynote speaker, Professor Samantha Karunaratne and Professor I.M. Dharmadas. I would also like to welcome the Chairman NIFS, Director NIFS, and all of you who are joining us online and those within the institute. NIFS is a national institute which conducts scientific research on fundamental and advanced studies, which emphasize for the advancement of sciences. The Young Scientist Association of NIFS was established in 2018 to create an environment to promote research culture and dynamic working and learning environment among the postgraduate students at NIFS. YSCMR 2022 is the fourth consecutive research conference organized by the YSC. The conference is organized under the four fields: political sciences, physical sciences, chemical sciences, and social sciences, for which we received abstract over 120 from both Sri Lankan and foreign students. While thanking all the members of the organizing committee, I congratulate and wish good luck to all the presenters who will be presenting today. We hope you will have a productive and enjoyable day at YSCMR 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahesh. And now I would like to invite upon stage Professor Saluka Kodithuakku, Director of the National Institute of Fundamental Studies, to address the gathering.
Good morning, everybody. Professor Athula Subhasipala, Chairman NIFS, keynote speakers, a scientist, Secretary NIFS, and the young scientist, and then the non-academic staff members, and the academic support staff members of the NIFS. Indeed, today it is a very good day, because as the director of the NIFS, I am proud of this young scientist of our institute. The main reason is, when I was a young scientist, actually I was struggling. Then I understood that this, as a young researchers, carrying out research is a very stressful job. Because when we start a research, or we pick a research project, with the guidance of our supervisor or supervisors, and then we carry out our research. But while carrying out research, we struggle to decide whether I am heading towards the correct directions, whether my work will be accepted by the society, and all sort of questions comes into the mind. There are many solutions for this. And our primary contact is our supervisors. Then we contact our supervisors and get their advice to make sure that we are carrying out our research correctly or without any doubt. But that is only one way. But there is another problem. What is the next problem is, though supervisors guide us to complete our research project, supervisors are not the ones who finally evaluate our thesis. Outside members evaluate our thesis. And therefore, we have to make sure that we carried out the research under the proper guidance and supervision of our supervisors. But at the same time, we have to make sure that we will get valuable feedback from other eminent scientists. And once again, for that one, we use two approaches. One is participate in scientific presentations like today, and present our research findings and check whether audience accept our work or criticize or provide us the constructive feedback, and based on that, we will discuss again with our supervisor, and perhaps sometimes we have to change the, our research directions and then the whatever the work we are carrying out. The other option is submit our research findings as research articles to the good journals, and then if the journal editorial board accept it, then that is another way of, you know, making sure that my work is, or our work is a good work. At the end of the day, the society will accept it. That is how we make sure that our research work is good or acceptable by the society. And for that, these young scientists, like our research assistants, there should be a platform to present their research findings. And that's what I said, I'm proud of our young scientists. They themselves organized this Young Scientists International Conference to present their research findings and then collect the valuable as well as the constructive feedback from not only their own supervisor, but other scientists of the NIFS as well as the other eminent scientists who listen to them. And then they also, I heard that this is the fourth consecutive conference of this nature, that is the international conference. That means you have experience in organizing the same conference three times, and this is the fourth time. And therefore, I hope that this conference is even better than the last year's conference. Then I also expect that whatever the constructive discussions you will face after you present your presentations, and then take them seriously and discuss with your supervisors, and then if necessary, that's only if necessary, and then develop your research project to a better one. And at the same time, I would like to request these young scientists, I have experience and also I have lot of experience regarding that. And then the when a fellow scientist, young scientist I'm talking about, when a fellow young scientist present the, his or her research findings, all the others kept dead silence without asking any question. Because they might think that asking questions may, you know, be a bad thing. Then because then my fellow research assistants presentation may not be, you know, good one or something like that. That is not only eminent scientists, even you can also provide constructive feedback to your own fellow young researchers and try to do that. I'm not telling that the if you don't understand what your fellow RA present, then there is no point of asking, you know, useless question. But if you think that the whatever the research work carried out by my fellow can be developed or improved further by doing something like this or so, then you have to express that. And then your fellow scientists will discuss with the supervisor, as I mentioned. That is a great help for your friends. And with that, once again, thanking the our buddy scientists for organizing this particular international conference and coming forward to present their research findings. I wish all the success for the conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. We have received a total of 120 abstracts under the various themes of our conference. And now, to launch the conference proceedings, I invite Dr. Shalini, advisor to the Young Scientists Association. Thank you, madam. The chairman of NIFS is joining with us online. We are humbled that you took some time off your busy schedule to grace us with your presence today. And now I would like to invite Professor Atula Sumathi Pala to address the gathering.
Thank you. Good morning to everybody. Professor Shalakwa Kodithuwakku, the director. Professor Samantha Karunaratna, the keynote speaker. Professor I.M. Dharmadasa, the second keynote speaker. Secretary to NIFS, Mrs. Sagarika Medivaka. All senior colleagues, junior colleagues, and young scientists. Thank you very much for inviting me to say a few words. I would have loved to be there physically. Unfortunately, the Ministry of Education is organizing another meeting. I have to leave just after this one for that, and also have got another assignment with Open University in the morning. So therefore, my apologies. Having said that, I'm delighted. Actually, the young scientists have managed to organize this for the fourth time. We know we faced an unprecedented global pandemic. In spite of that, over the last 3 years, we have, our young scientists have held this conference uninterruptedly. And it's so, I'm so glad to hear that you have received 120 abstracts. As Professor Kodithuwakku very clearly highlighted, doing research is one thing, but disseminating them, sharing them with your colleagues is very, very important, because no research is perfect. The researcher who does the research in one way, by sharing the findings, open the option for further discussion, try to find the gaps in that research which the person or the team doesn't see. And as Professor Kodithuwakku correctly said, others to come up with constructive criticism. In other words, to say how could it be done differently if somebody else do it or the same team does it. Because one piece of research is not going to solve the issue. It's the culmination of different research projects synthesize the greater knowledge. So he was very right, and therefore it's an absolutely must to share, publish your research, because as academics, as researchers, we only carry the knowledge left by others and trying to advance. Nobody wants that research. We also use public funding. So therefore we have to be transparent, accountable by sharing our findings with other colleagues, which can advance and sharpen the research you have done. Now, it's very important we do research as we do at NIFS. We are celebrating our 40 years at an institution which was founded 40 years ago for fundamental and advanced research. And research is the way forward for any nation to develop. It's very crucial that post-industrial knowledge economy today clearly displays close correlation among economic growth, innovation, and indigenous research capacity. And NIFS, being the only institution in Sri Lanka which has full-time researchers, research staff, professors doing research, we have a fundamental moral and ethical obligation to advance research and walk our talk by being exemplary institution. So I'm so glad with the arrival of new director and secretary, we have actually ironed out some of the issues we had, which were hindrance for progress and were barriers. And I'm so happy to see that research is progressing. The key component for the transformation we need, in a way, as a paradigm shift in the strategy, is to increase the resources through investment, spot and harness young talent, recruit and retain the best researchers, and make essential structural changes. We all know, under this global pandemic, global economic recession, we are also faced with a lot of challenges. But remember, money and the funding is not the only component or the ingredient we need to advance research. 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago, there were no grants. People dedicated their own time and the wealth they earned to advance science. You and I benefit through that knowledge generation And as people who use that knowledge, we have a fundamental and moral duty to share our knowledge and also cater to the society. Research is for public good. It's not just for glorification. It's not just for publishing papers and getting promotion. And it's not just earning degrees. So with that, I would want to say that I wish all the very best to the Young Scientists Association. I really appreciate and admire the considerable amount of work gone in. And I also thank and really appreciate the senior colleagues who have given a helping hand, guidance, and unhesitant and unrepentant commitment to advance the course of conducting research in our country. I wish you all the best for a successful conference and pray courage to you all to continue as budding scientists and be future research leaders in our country. Thank you very much. And I would like to apologize once again, having to leave after my talk to go to the ministry. Thank you all. A successful day.
Thank you very much, sir. And now a small video clip will be played from our platinum sponsor.
ස්වයංපෝෂිත ආර්ථික ක්‍රමයේ යටතේ මුදල් භාවිතය ඉතා අඩුවෙන් සම්බන්ධ වූ අතර හෝමාරු මාධ්‍ය භාණ්ඩ හෝමාරුවට සීමා වේ. ලංකාවේ මුලින් භාවිත වූ මුදල් තහවණු පුරාණ ලෙස නම් වූ අතර ඒවා ඉන්දියානු සම්භවයක් ඇති මුදල් ලේඛක විය. අලියතුන්, අශ්වයින්, රෙදිපිලි, කවඩි, කපු, ඇත්වල, මැණික් හම්, සහල්, ලුණු ආදී ඕනෑම ද්‍රව්‍යයක් මුදල් ලෙස විවිධ අවස්ථාවල විවිධ ස්ථානවලදී භාවිත විය. ලංකාවේ එකල භාවිත වූ මුදල්, ඉන්දියාවේ භාවිත වූ මුදල්, විශේෂයෙන් දකුණු ඉන්දියාවේ මුදල් ලේඛකවරට දර්ශීය විය. පැරණි වංශ කතා, ශිලා ලේඛන දක්වන්නේ ආදි ලංකාවේ මූල්‍ය පද්ධතිය විජය රජතුමාගේ කාලයේ සිට පැවතෙන බවයි. එම මුදල් ලේඛක බොහෝ විට ඉලක්කම් හා බර ප්‍රමාණවලට සම්බන්ධව යොමු කොට තිබුණි. මෙම මුදල් ලේඛක ප්‍රථමයෙන් ඉන්දියාවේ භාවිත වූ බවට විශ්වාස කරන අතර ඉන්පසුව බුදුදහම ලක්දිවට ලැබීමටත් පෙර ලංකාවේ භාවිත වූ බව විශ්වාස කරේ. එක්දහස් පන්සිය පහේ සිට මොහොතිබඩ පළාත්වල පෘතුගීසි, ලන්දේසි, ඉංග්‍රීසි, විදේශීය ආක්‍රමණ මොතකා උඩරට මහනුවර රාජධානිය එහි ස්වාධීනත්වය රඳවා ගත්ත. නමුත් අවසානයේ 1815 බ්‍රිතාන්‍ය පාලනයට යටත්වීම සිදු විය. බ්‍රිතාන්‍යයන් දිවයින සිතුවම් ගත කර මාර්ග පද්ධතියක් හා දුම්රිය මාර්ග පද්ධතියක් එලි කර මධ්‍යම ප්‍රදේශය විවෘත කරන ලදී. එකල වෙවිලි කර්මාන්තයේ නිෂ්පාදන අපනයනට අවතීර්ණ වීමටද හැකි විය. ලංකාවේ ආර්ථිකය විවිධාංගීකරණය කිරීමත් මුදල් ලබා දීමත් දේශීය ව්‍යවසායිකයන්ගේ අවශ්‍යතා සැපිරීම සඳහා දේශීය බැංකුවක් ස්ථාපිත කිරීමේ අවශ්‍යතාව පැන නැගුණා. ලංකා රාජ්‍ය සභාව බැංකු කොමිසමේ නිර්දේශ මත දේශීය බැංකුවක් ස්ථාපිත කිරීම අනුමත කළා. අගෝස්තු පළවෙනි දින ලංකා බැංකුව උත්සවාකාරයෙන් සිටි ඔෆිස් ගොඩනැගිල්ලේ ස්ථාපිත කර විවෘත කෙරුණා. පත්‍රකාරීත්වය නොතකා වර්ධනය වුණා. ලංකාවේ ප්‍රථම ශාඛාව 1941 අගෝස්තු 15 දින දරමි ලංකාවේ කන්ද උඩරට අගනුවර මහනුවරදී ආරම්භ කළා. දී ලංකා බැංකුව ජනසතු කිරීමෙන් පසු බිම් මට්ටමේ සිට මුළු දේශීයටම සීවී සැපීමේ උතුම් කර්තව්‍ය පැවරුණා. 1970 වනදී ලංකා බැංකුවේ සියලු ගනුදෙනු මිනිස්කමින් සිදු කළ අතර එම යුගයේදී භාවිත කළ ඇස්කෝටා සහ බාරස් උපකරණ ගිලුම් කටයුතු සිදු කිරීමට ඉතා විශාල කාර්යයක් ඉටු කළා. 1971 අර්බු ඉලෙක්ට්‍රොනික ක්‍රමයක් හඳුන්වා අතර ඉන්පසු සියලුම බැංකු ගනුදෙනු සම්පූර්ණයෙන්ම පරිගණක ගත කරනු ලදී. අද ලංකා බැංකුව දේශීය ශාඛා 638ක් සහ ලන්ඩන්, චෙන්නයි, මාලි සහ සීෂෙල්ස් හි ඊතර බැංකු ශාඛා 5ක් මගින් සිය දේශීය ජාත්‍යන්තර සංවර්ධන හා ආයෝජන බැංකු කටයුතු පවත්වාගෙන යන ළමයි. මේ වන විට දිවයින පුරා වීදුණු 1200කට අධික ATM සේවා ස්ථාන උපයෝගී කර ගනිමින් වඩා කාර්යක්ෂම සේවාවක් මහජනතාවට ලබා දීමේ හැකියාව බැංකුව නතු කරගත්තා. පැරණි බැංකු පාස්පොත් අලුත් කරමින් ස්මාර්ට් පාස්බුක් නමින් ඉලෙක්ට්‍රොනික පාස්පොතක් හඳුනා දුන් අතර එමගින් ගිණුම සමග ඩිජිටල් මාධ්‍යයෙන් සම්බන්ධ වීමේ හැකියාව ලබා දුන්නා. තරුණයේ සිතුම් පැතුම් හඳුනා ගනිමින් මොබයිල් බැංකින් ඇප් එක හඳුනා දීමත් විශේෂිතයි. එමගින් ඔබේ ඇඟිලි තුඩේ දුරට බැංකුව ගෙනෙමින් නිවසේ සිටම පහසුවෙන් බැංකු කටයුතු සිදු කර ගැනීමේ අවස්ථාව පිරිනැමුණා. ශාකා පරිසරයන්ගෙන් බැහැරව පොදු ස්ථානයන්හි පිහිට වූ ස්වයංක්‍රීය බැංකු එකක මගින් මහජනතාව වෙත වඩාත් සමර්ථ කාර්යක්ෂම සේවාවක් සැපයීමට හැකි වුණා. ලංකාවේ ප්‍රථම වතාවට පූර්ණ ඩිජිටල් බැංකු ශාඛාවක් මහනුවර කැන්ඩි සිටි සෙන්ටර් හිදී විවෘත කරනු ලැබුවා. බැංකු කරන කටයුතු ගමට ගෙනියාමේ නියමුවා බවට ලංකා බැංකුව පත් වෙමින් බ්‍රාන්ච් ඔෆිස් සංකල්පය හඳුන්වා දෙනු ලැබුවා.
And now I would like to invite on stage Professor Cyril Vijayasundara to introduce our first keynote speaker of the day, Professor Samantha Karunarathne.
Yaman NIFS Professor Sumathi Pala, Director NIFS Professor Chalu Kodukaku. United keynote speakers, Professor Dharmadasa and Professor Karunarathne, Secretary NIFS Nadiyuka, fellow scientists and students and the other distinguished invitees and interested people participating both physically and virtually. So it's my task to introduce the first keynote speaker, who is Samantha Karunarathne. In fact, I came to know Samantha when he was a graduate student. He graduated from Peradeniya University having obtained a BSc special degree in botany in 2006. And after that, he was appointed as a lecturer at the University of Rajarhata in the Faculty of Applied Sciences for about 2 years. And in 2010, he joined Ma Pha Luang University in Thailand to do his PhD under Professor Kevin Hyde. Of course, some of you may know that he is leading the probably one of the best mycological groups in this part of the world, if not the best group in the world. And he obtained his PhD in 2016. That was about 6 years ago, right? 2016 and this is 2020. Now, during this six-year period, he published over 200 SCI publications during these 6 years. And also, his H index is 35, 6 years, right? And then, in fact, when I was given this little note about his, brief biodata, the citations were 6,600. And then last evening, I checked and found it was 6,934. And this morning, just before I started my this introduction, I checked and it was 6,946 during this 6 hours. So at this rate, by the time we end this seminar, it will be almost 7,000, right? So this is a young scientist who is doing productive research, and also, although he is working in Thailand, he is not losing touch with Sri Lankan research. He has published a lot in Sri Lankan, with one Sri Lankan fungi, especially on mushrooms, and even he is supervising a graduate student, Bhagya Premaratna, in my lab, and he is working with me in our lab. He is part of the team. He's a good candidate for adjunct professorship because he's doing a lot while in foreign country. He's working with Sri Lankan scientists and also supervising students and so on. So currently he's attached to the Beijing Normal University in Yunnan, China, as a professor. Is actually attached to the Center for Yunnan Plateau Biological Resources Protection and Utilization. And I've been following his progress over the years, and I found that he's a very popular personality in China. In Chinese newspapers, every other month or so, there's an article, news item about Samantha's findings in mushrooms. It's a very fascinating subject. And it's very interesting that both keynote speakers are doing, although they are in different fields, biology and physics, they are doing research which are dear to us. I mean, we can understand what he's talking. I mean, both of them, I'm sure. Later we'll listen to Professor Dharmadas. He's also doing something common to, important advanced research. But, everybody can, a layman can understand. Same here with Professor Samantha's research. His findings, I'm sure it will be very interesting. So he's going to talk about the remark. His title of this keynote address is "The Remarkable Potential of Fungi." And so I now invite Professor Samantha Chandranath Karunaratne to address the gathering. Thank you.
Good morning, professors, researchers, students, ladies and gentlemen. I am very honored to have been chosen to deliver a keynote speech of Young Scientist Conference on Multidisciplinary Research. First of all, I thank the organizing committee for inviting me to deliver a keynote speech in this wonderful conference. The topic of my speech is remarkable potential of fungi. So without taking much time, I'll start my speech. Let's see what are fungi. So fungi are a group of eukaryotic organisms that includes microorganisms such as yeast, mold, you see sometimes on bread, and more familiar, mushrooms. So all these are called generally fungi. So these organisms are classified as a separate kingdom. So let's see why we need to study fungi. So as you all know, fungi are the most diverse and ecologically important organism on the earth. And according to the global estimation, the estimated number ranges from 2.2 to 13.2 million. So you can see the diversity is huge. But as of 2022, only around 150,000 species of fungi have been described. So there is a huge gap between the predicted and the described number. But the sad news is that fungi everywhere are declining in both quantity and diversity. And even some species are under threat or are likely to go extinct. So fungi and their habitat need to be protected, as same as so many other organisms, because the habitat health and fungal health are interlinked. So of the 120,000 species that were assessed for IUCN red list of threatened species, only 371 are fungi, but the rest are animals and plants. So do you think the fungi are ignored in conservation plans? Let's see why. You know, fungi fruit for only a few days a year. Their fruit bodies appear and then disappear rapidly. So at first glimpse, fungal diversity is not readily apparent. So you don't see fungi throughout the year. So most importantly, without a proper record of their presence, they remain ignored, understudied, misunderstood, and unprotected. So fungi are relatively understudied group, but they are essential, charming, and valuable group of organisms with an impossible biotechnological potential for industrial application. So the long story short, fungi are incredibly understudied compared to their sister kingdoms, animals and plants. So you can see in this graph, if you look at the scientific articles published each year, you can see animals, there are a lot of publications, and plants, so a lot of publications. But if you look at fungi, very few publications are there compared to animals and plants. So coming back to see the Sri Lankan micota. So Sri Lankan micota may contain up to 34,000 species, of which only slightly more than 3,000 are currently known to science. So there is a huge gap in between the predicted and the described number. So, the identification of mushrooms, microfungi, and lichens is an important part of mycological research in any country, and Sri Lanka is no exception. So, epitypification of old type specimens is also an important part of Sri Lankan mycology. So epitypification means that you describe a new type for the type species that have been described long ago. So those specimens that were described long ago are not in good condition. So we need to describe new types to replace these old types. So, coming back to fungi again, fungi are cosmopolitan. So, cosmopolitan means they're distributed in different habitats. So, they have different survival mechanisms to survive in different environments. So these unique characteristics of fungi provide great potential for their application in biotechnology and industry. So you can see here some examples, rust on a plant leaf and human pathogen, Tinea corporis on a human body, and Pilobolus crystallizes on pieces of a herbivore. And when we talk about potential in biotechnology and industry, there was a paper published recently in Fungal Diversity, 50 ways we can exploit fungi industry. So this publication discussed a lot of potentials about fungi. So the remarkable potential of fungi can be classified into main points. First is strategies against human disease and strategies against plant disease, enhancing crop and forestry, food and beverages, saving the planet, and commodities. So in this picture you can see fungal enzymes and their applications mentioned in the publication that was published in Fungal Diversity. So when we talk about strategies against human disease, the first thing comes into our mind is penicillin, the first antibiotic. It's a secondary metabolite of Penicillium notatum. So this is produced when crop of the fungus inhibited by stress. As you know, if a fungus is stressed, so then the fungus start to secrete different secretory metabolites. So this does not produce this secondary metabolite during its active growth. So Alexander, Sir Alexander Fleming was the one who discovered the great antibiotic penicillin. So this discovery revolutionized the medicine. And the next important drug is cyclosporine. So this cyclosporine is a secondary metabolite of Toliprofradium infladum. So this fungus is a soil fungus screened for antibiotics, and this produces cyclosporine, a weak antibiotic. So strongly active in suppressing the immune system. We call immunosuppressive drug. So when a new organ is transplanted to human body, so the human body always refuses the organ. So in order to stop refusing this organ, the doctors always give this immunosuppressive drug, cyclosporine. So this is a very important drug in modern medicine. And the next potential of fungi is fungi with the anti-diabetic properties. So as you can see here, some mushrooms are well known as anti-diabetic mushroom. So Agaricus bisporus, so we call button mushroom. Agaricus campestris, we call field mushroom. And Ophiocordyceps sinensis and Tremella fusiformis, Hericium hericinus, or we call monkey head, and in what as obliquus or chaga mushroom, and Agaricus subrufescens, or we call almond mushroom. Because of the almond smell of this mushroom, this is called almond mushroom. So these mushrooms are well known as anti-diabetic mushrooms. And the next important strategy of fungi, strategies against plant disease. So as you may know, endophytic fungi are used as biocontrol agents. So here you can see some examples. The endophytic fungi are used to test whether they can control some plant pathogens. So these experiments are the initial experiments before these fungi are developed as biocontrol agents. And the other important fungi are the entomopathogenic fungi, or the fungi that kill insects. So these fungi can be used to control some of the plant pathogenic insects or pests. One example is Provenia braziana. So this is also now widely used as a biocontrol agent to control some plant diseases, plant disease causing insects. And the other important thing is control plant parasitic nematodes. So some fungi are able to capture these plant parasitic nematodes by their mycelia. So these fungi can be developed as biocontrol agents to control the plant parasitic nematodes in soil. So one example is Trichoderma and also nematode trapping fungi we call. And the next potential of fungi is the enhancing crops and forestry. So some fungi are used as biofertilizers. So this means that these fungi, when applied into the soil, so the fungi can help the plant to absorb water and minerals faster than normal rate. So this can help the plant to grow better. So this is very environmental friendly and also low cost than the chemical fertilizer. And the other important thing is plant growth promoting fungi. So these fungi, when applied into soil, so they help the plant growth by also controlling the stress and also improving the absorption. So these are very important strategies of fungi. And when we talk about food and beverages, so blue cheese is made from Penicillium roqueforti and Camembert cheese, Penicillium camemberti, and soy sauce, Aspergillus oryzae, and the boiled smut of maize, Eustilago maidii, and edible mushrooms you are familiar with, and also the bakery industry, yeast is used, yeast, the Saccharomyces cerevisiae, or we call baker's yeast, and also in the beer and wine industry, we call brewer's yeast is used, and also the Vegemite or Marmite is also a product of yeast. Saving the planet. So this is also one of the hot topics now. So fungi has this ability to degrade plastic or plastic products. So some fungi are able to biodegrade the polyester polyurethane or PU. So we discovered a fungus recently, Aspergillus tubigenesis. So this fungus can degrade PU or polyurethane, and the result were promising, and now we are trying to improve this strain, and also trying to find out new fungal strains that can degrade plastic efficiently. So you can see the fungus, the structures of the fungus here, and also when we talk about saving the planet, the other important thing that fungi can do is the process of mycoremediation. So mycoremediation is the cleaning up of the environment by using fungi. For example, some fungi are able to absorb heavy metals and pesticides, insecticides in the soil. So if we apply these kind of fungi to the polluted soil, so the fungi can clean up the soil. And the next potential of fungi is the commodity. So as you may all already know that some fungi or the mushrooms are used in cosmetic industry. And for example, Tremella sinensis and Ganoderma lucidum, they are widely used in this cosmetic industry. And these are some of the products that you can see in markets, especially when you travel. You can see these kind of products in duty free shops, and also the cosmetic shops. So this is this product, Mega Mushroom Skin Relief, is a very popular product, and you may see this very often in cosmetics and the duty free shops. And when we talk about commodities, the next important thing is eka wood and its products. So eka wood is known as the most expensive natural product on the planet. So a very good eka wood is sold for very high prices. And scientists believe that this the resin of the eka wood is produced because of the fungal attack into the eka wood tree, and in response the tree produces this resin to cover up the infected area. So this is still under experiments. So we are also doing some experiments to find out which fungi are responsible for this eka wood production. Because the natural eka wood production is very slow. Now scientists are trying to find artificial ways to induce eka wood production. So one of the ways is to damage the eka wood tree so that the fungi can easily attack the tree, and then as a response the tree produces the eka wood. Coming back to the research we are doing in our research group, so we have 7 PhD students and 1 master student. So all the students are doing research on micro and macrophagy. So this is one of the students, Vidu. She works on taxonomy, phylogeny, and secondary metabolites of microfungi associated with coffee in Yunnan province of China. So she's in her second year. And she has published four total publications at the moment. And she also works on the endophytic fungi of a coffee plant. And she is trying to find out some effective strain that can control some bacterial and fungal pathogens. And later we can develop these as effective biocontrol agents. And this is TNE2. Her research topic is taxonomy, phylogeny, and potential agout compounds of fungi from Aquilaria or the agout tree. So she is also in her second year now, and she also has published 5 first author publications. And she is also trying to find out some effective endophytic fungi that can control bacterial and fungal pathogens. She's also trying to find out some fungi that can induce the egg out production. So this is Rui Fan Xu. She's also a PhD student, and she works on taxonomy and phylogeny of saprobic fungi on rubber and screening of rubber degrading fungi. She's also in her second year, and she has published 3 first author publications. And she discovered 3 fungal strains recently. And these fungal strains showed promising results of biodegrading the PU or polyurethane. So these are some of the results that she obtained. So soon we will finalize this manuscript, and also we are in the process of working on these fungi further to see how effective they are in degrading plastic. And this is Fu Yang. He is a master's student, and he was able to publish 5 first author publications for his master's. So his master's thesis is on endophytic and saprobic fungi associated with mangoes and the potential of endophytic fungi as biocontrol agents against selected mango pathogens. So he also isolated a lot of endophytic strains from mango, and he has done some experiments to see which fungi are effective in controlling fungal and bacterial pathogens. So he found that some Ketonium species are able to control some bacterial and fungal pathogens very effectively. So we are now in the process of studying these Ketonium species for further to develop biocontrol agents. And this is Xiaofu Liu. So he has published 3 first author publications. He's also in his second year now. And his thesis title is Taxonomy, Phylogeny, and Pathological Importance of Cave and Bed Fungi. So he isolated the fungi from bat wings and legs and the mouth part, and it was amazing that he was able to find a lot of new species of fungi from bats and also caves. So we are trying to find out whether these bats act as the carriers of some plant and animal pathogens, because they often fly in and out from caves, so they might transport some bacterial and fungal pathogens from these unique habitats to the crops and also for animals and humans. So this is Qingguo Tian. So his thesis title is the taxonomy and phylogeny of saprobic fungi associated with selected economically important monocotyledons in China and Thailand. So he is in his third year now. So he has published five first author publications, and he is working on his last publication these days. And this is Wenhua Lu. He's also a PhD student, and he just started his PhD. So his thesis title is Taxonomy and Phylogeny Studies of Bioluminescent Mushroom. So he is still trying to find out these bioluminescent mushrooms from different places in Yunnan province. And this is one of the bioluminescent mushrooms we discovered from northeast of India. We described it as a new species, Rhodomyces phylloscriptis. And this is another bioluminescent mushroom. We discovered it in Yunnan province of China, Rhodomyces viridodomini. And this is another new species we discovered in tropical part of China, Flavellagia tibigensis. So these three new species we discovered over the last 2 years. And this is becoming becoming an interesting topic now, because until now, scientists have not understood why fungi have bioluminescence. There are different theories, but none of the theories explain the real reason why fungi have bioluminescence. So, I would like to share some special issues related to fungi that I am running. So, if any of you would like to submit your manuscript to these special issues, you are welcome to submit, and also you are welcome to contact me if you need any help regarding the submission or any issues related to your manuscripts. So one special issue we run in Journal of Fungi on polyphasic identification of fungi. And another special issue in biology, plant fungi interaction. And another special issue in diversity, the hidden fungal diversity in Asia. And another special issue in agronomy, mycorrhizal fungi in sustainable agriculture and land restoration. And another special issue in frontiers in microbiology on plant fungi interaction. And we have another multidisciplinary topic in five journals: Diversity, Journal of Fungi, Microorganisms, Pathogens, and Life. This is also on fungal diversity. So, I think that's all. Thank you very much. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank again for the organizing committee of YSCMR for organizing this wonderful event and inviting me to deliver a keynote speech. So this is our research team. We have three researchers. This is a Chinese researcher, Dr. Dong Qingdai, and this is my wife, Dr. Saola Kripoma, and myself, and all others are our students. So I wish the YSDMR conference a great success, and if you need any help, please feel free to contact me via my email address, and I am very happy to help anyone who needs help to carry out the fungal research. As I understood, we have a lot of research need to be done in Sri Lanka, and I know how hard it is to carry out research these days, but I am very happy to help as much as I can if anyone needs. Thank you very much.
The keynote speech was previously recorded for technical convenience. However, we have Professor Karunaratna with us online, and now I would like to invite Professor Karunaratna to speak a few words to encourage us.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much, Cyril sir, for introducing me. And also, thank you very much to the organizing committee of YSDMR 2022 for inviting me to deliver the keynote speech for this important event. And I am very honored to have been chosen to deliver the wonderful event. And as a past graduate of University of Tanzania, it was a wonderful moment that I had, that I have been chosen to deliver the keynote speech. So if I speak about the research and how important the research that we carry out. So as the research we are doing in our group, even though we didn't realize that there are so many research we can do in this fungi research. So I just want to show you that don't think that you cannot do enough research if you don't have enough resources. You don't have enough guidance, or you don't have enough people to support you. When I was doing research, I also struggled a lot, but I was not discouraged myself. I thought I will somehow carry out the research, try to do some good research in this fungi field. So, for you, I encourage you to come forward and do research as much as possible. And when you need some help, you can contact me or anyone in our research team. As Cyril sir mentioned, I'm also doing some research with some researchers in Sri Lanka. So we have Professor Naveen. He's also doing some research in Sri Lanka. And so we are trying to help people who need help in Sri Lanka in terms of the advisors, and also we also try to help them with some stuff they need to carry out research in Sri Lanka. So we don't want people to struggle like we did earlier. We want people to carry out more research and come forward. You can see the countries like Thailand, China, they develop of research because they invest a lot of money on it and they do a lot of good research. So we also want Sri Lanka to do some good research because we have a lot of brains in Sri Lanka. We just need to give them support. So then we can get a lot of productive research from our country. So don't ever discourage yourself. Come forward and try to do some good research. We have a lot of things to do in Sri Lanka. If you need help, please free to contact us. Also, you can tell Cyril sir, because we are doing research with him. So we all can do some good stuff together. So thank you very much again for inviting me for this wonderful event. And I hope more young scientists will carry out research on fungi in Sri Lanka. And if you need any help, please feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Next, I would like to call upon stage Ms. Prasanga Amarasena, YACMR Conference Co-Chair, to deliver the vote of thanks. Thank you, Anupama. Very good morning to you all. The Chairman of NIFS, the Director of NIFS, distinguished guests, and all of you who are joining us online and those who are within the Institute. I deem it a great honor to propose a vote of thanks on behalf of the YACMR 2022 Organizing Committee. YACMR 2022 has been organized parallel to the National Science Week, which is held between 10th November to 17th November. First and foremost, I wish to express my gratitude to the invited keynote speakers, Professor I.M. Dharmadasa, Professor at Sheffield Hallam University, UK, and Professor Samantha Karunaratne, Professor at College of Biological Resources and Food Engineering at Kuijin Normal University, China, for accepting our invitation amidst your busy schedule. Organizing an event of this scale would not be possible without funding. So I would like to thank our exclusive platinum sponsor, Bank of Ceylon, Sri Lanka, and sponsor Mr. Gamini Silva. Further, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to the chairman, Professor Athula Sumathipala, the director, Professor Saluka Koditwakku, and all the NIFS scientists for guiding us throughout the organizing process. Also, I would like to thank the secretary and the accountant of NIFS for providing us with the necessary facilities. Moreover, as a co-chair of YACMR 2022, I would like to thank our editing chief, Professor N.K.B. Adhikaram, for his guidance throughout the organizing process and to the editorial board. I would also like to take this opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to all the reviewers for their immense support throughout the reviewing process. The event will not be succeeded without encouraging advice and guidance. Therefore, I would extend my heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Shalini Rajakaruna and Dr. Lakmal Jayaratna, the advisors to the Young Scientists Association. An event like this cannot happen overnight. We have been indeed fortunate enough to be backed by a very dedicated organizing committee and science education and dissemination unit led by Dr. Kumari Tilakaratna. I am very proud to say that we have a very enthusiastic and committed group of research assistants at NIFS who deserve a very big thanks. I would also like to thank the staff of NIFS for their support in numerous ways and those who have gone unmentioned. Further, I extend my sincere thanks to all authors, co-authors, and their supervisors for their contribution by submitting abstract to make this conference a success. Finally, on behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to thank all the presenters and congratulate you all for presenting your research finding at YSEMR 2022. We thank you all for being with us today. Hope you will have a productive and enjoyable day. Thank you.
Thank you, Lasanga. This brings us to the end of the inauguration session. The technical sessions will commence at 10:15, soon after the tea break. Today's conference will be held in 5 parallel sessions as Biological Sciences 1 and 2, Chemical Sciences, Physical Sciences, and Social Sciences. You can find the links for each session from the official YSCMR website. Thank you, and we'll join soon after the tea break. Hope you have a fruitful day.